So the sticker we're talking about this time is this Jeff Grosso bat person sticker. Topical. This is the quarantine episode. I haven't left my house and immediate neighborhood for close to 3 weeks. Just to walk the dog. Picked up food once. Lost 3 pounds, which is good. That's not bad. That's good. I had the extra to lose. And I hope you guys are good out there to the 300 people or so who watch this, because it's getting super weird. But I hope you're safe. And this is a real good time to go through your stickers and reorganize them and categorize them, catalog them, write notes, organize them by theme, company, color, your emotional feelings towards them. Do whatever you want, because guess what? You've got time. This sticker is very popular and very expensive. It's based on a design for a Jeff Grosso deck that came out in 1987, page 201 of the Disposable Skateboard Bible. Now, it's done by Jim Phillips, kinda. We're gonna get to that. I don't remember how I got this. I think I got this sticker in a trade. I think this is one of the stickers I traded. A woman wanted a drawing I did of a guy holding a deck for her boyfriend's birthday, and traded me two pages of his sticker album for it. And I believe this came in that, which is great, because this sticker, these are a total ripoff. There's like one on eBay right now. I think it's $87. Which, like, dude, relax. Is it gold? Does it come with a ventilator? No. It's just a sticker. I wish they'd reissue these, to be honest, because that would be great. You could buy a ton of them, because it is a really great design. The other version of this, there's another, like, wider wing version of this that's even more expensive, so I think it's a little rarer. It's a very popular design because this was a really popular graphic in the 80s when it came out. Jeff Grosso was a very popular skater, but Jeff Grosso, I think, almost is more popular now because of his love letters to skateboarding YouTube show. Grosso is great. He's hilarious. He's very authentic. He's very willing to offer up his opinions and tell you what he thinks. He's also willing to admit when he's super wrong and what he doesn't know as much as what he knows. At this point, he's like a skateboard historian, but not like the boring kind. He's very authentic. And because he is a famous pro skateboarder, he has access to all these skaters who will tell him their stories. So you get it kind of from the inside. It's like a rock and roll documentary, but skateboarding. He's like the David Attenborough of skateboard history, but like fun. David Attenborough's fun, but different kind of fun. That's why I think maybe the Grosso stuff is so expensive. It's because people like him. We like his personality. We like his, like, viewpoint. I like his viewpoint because he's, like, equal parts grizzled, bitter old dude and not. He's not like, oh, these kids today. He's not that guy at all. He'll poke fun at some of the corporatization of skateboarding, but, like, he's also super open and down to what the young skaters are doing, and that they're doing their own thing, and that's what happens, and that's what's supposed to happen. So, like, yeah, his perspective is very valuable because it's, like, of another generation, but he also understands that something like skateboarding is always going to be in the hands of the youth, and that's where it belongs. And I absolutely agree. What the kids are doing now is great. The graphics that are being made right now, some of them are tremendous. So that's sort of like, things aren't as good. They kind of aren't, but they kind of are. It's obviously of a bat person holding its wings up. We have a angel above holding a flag with a heart on it. So I don't know if that's supposed to be Cupid or whatever. It's adult angel. It's got blonde hair. Kind of a page boy. He-Man cut. He's got bangs. Cute. Does that mean he's going through an emotional crisis where he cut bangs? Kind of freaking out. It's got the letter in Latin, which is cool. 87 in Latin. Now it has the doll, the Grosso doll graphic, dead in the corner on some rocks, which that's pretty cool. It's making reference to one of his other graphics, the toy box graphic, which is a great graphic. I have that. We'll get to that another time. The real reason I want to talk about the sticker is to talk to you about Virgil Finlay. Now, this isn't art that's inspired by Virgil Finlay. This isn't art that reminds me of Virgil Finlay. This is a lift. Oops. I didn't know about this at first. This came to me years ago on Instagram. I was looking at something and I was looking at this graphic and I was reading some comments and someone was like, "Well, if you like that graphic, you should know that it's Virgil Finlay." And I was like, "Who's Virgil Finlay?" And so I looked him up and Virgil Finlay is the person who drew this. And you're saying, "Hey, did he draw this after 1987?" No. Because Virgil Finlay was born in 1914 and he died in 71, long before this was made. So that's impossible. So what we're seeing here is essentially theft. Now, it's not the first time this happened. This happens a lot in art and design. I can tell that Jim Phillips was a huge fan of Virgil Finlay because this is not the only Virgil Finlay piece of illustration that shows up in Santa Cruz graphics. Tom Knox, there's Kendall. So clearly, as a young man, Jim Phillips enjoyed the sci-fi illustration of Virgil Finlay. Virgil Finlay, for my money, is as good at black and white illustration as anyone in the history of the fucking planet. This guy is an absolute monster. His ability with ink is so insanely good, I can't even believe it. Like, I look through these, and by the way, this was done in 1950. No Photoshop. I don't even think they had photocopiers. This is done in pen and ink. I've read about him. He got his first like illustration job in his 20s. He worked a lot for this magazine called Weird Tales, which was a sci-fi magazine. He was really into sci-fi, like literature and stuff. And I read about him, and he used what we call the stippling technique, which is lots of little dots. And he was so obsessed with getting perfect dots, he used like, not like a needle, but like a metal, very sharp metal, like almost like a nail sharpened. Almost like a doctor instrument that you'd poke a hole in, like a hole punch type situation. Tiny. He would dip it in ink, he'd make a dot, clean it off, dip it in ink, make another dot, clean it off. That's a level of meticulousness I don't know that any of us can relate to or will really go to that degree. He routinely was late with his job commissions because he took so long to make them so perfect, but look up the art of Virgil Finlay. It's bananas. Sci-fi art, gets a bad rap for being kind of lowbrow and not fine art. But there is some artwork in there that is so beautiful and so well made and also well imagined. We're not talking things you can shoot reference for. You can't like go take a picture of a space alien that's like half snake, half man, wrapping around a flying saucer. You got to invent that stuff. A lot of what you see in Finlay's work is invented. He uses a lot of like reference. He's clearly taking photographs of people and working from life, but he's combining that with elements out of his head. And they're drawn with a level of realism and draftsmanship that is so rare and so well done. It's mind-blowing. When I looked through this stuff, I thought I was like, "Oh, this is obviously done with like collage and you used it." No. This dude sat there and drew it. It's crazy how good this guy was. And I'm just a huge fan of him. It's almost like I don't really care that this is stolen, to be honest with you, because I would have never known about Virgil Finlay if not for him showing up in these graphics. Like, maybe I would have seen it on Instagram, but I wouldn't have wanted to hunt down images. Because once I found out this was a lift, I was like, well, did he lift other stuff? And, I was like, oh, he did. Now, there's like different accounts from people that worked in the Jim Phillips studio or whatever, but I don't think he was trying to hide it. It doesn't seem like it. According to an illustrator that worked there, he would just bring in the Finley book and be like, this one, like, do this, Like the little people in the flames, that's lifted from a Virgil Finley illustration. Like, he obviously realized this person's art was a treasure trove of stuff you could use for skateboard graphics. So now that brings us to the idea of authorship. There's been a lot of things in skateboard graphics that you could call appropriated. That's what's great about skateboard graphics a lot of the times, especially late, towards the late 80s, early 90s, when there was a bunch of new smaller companies, Blind 101, things like that. They were doing a lot of like funny kind of corporate stealing. There's a Jeff Grosso deck that's basically a Coca-Cola logo. But this is different because when you do that, when you steal a Coca-Cola logo or the Dianetics logo, that's being like kind of punk. You're kind of poking at corporate America. You're kind of saying like, fuck you, we're skaters, we'll do what we want, we'll steal your graphic, who cares? Because the idea of like a skater working at McDonald's or skating for Coke was ridiculous then. Now it's not as much, Red Bull. But it was a bit of a like, we're different, we're not part of this world, so we're gonna steal your stuff. This is not that. This is seeing a beautiful piece of art and liking it so much, you're like, I can't resist. I'm going to steal this because it's so cool. And Phillips, as what you could say as an art director, knew that some of Finley's illustrations would work so well as skateboard graphics, he just couldn't resist. And since Virgil Finlay was dead, I don't know. There was no one to stop him. I don't know if he licensed this stuff. I don't know if he communicated with the Virgil Finley's family or his estate. I have no idea. I maybe, hopefully, maybe cut him a check. I don't know. But this is a lift of it's happened in art history. Artists do it. It's a bummer, but skateboarding was a new thing. It wasn't being taken seriously by like anybody. So you can kind of get the rationale where he's like, this is just, these things are going to be torn up. They're bought by kids. This art's great. Put it on the board. We'll sell a million. They sold hundreds of thousands of these decks. So could you compartmentalize it as kind of greed? Maybe. Is it like kind of lazy? Maybe. Is it responsible for some of the best graphics Santa Cruz made? Totally. That Tom Knox one, this one, the Kendall one. They're some of the most iconic graphics from that time period. And it's because Virgil Finlay rules, you know? I mean, look at this stuff. This guy rips. Like, that's just pen and ink, man. You want to talk cross-hatching ability? This guy puts crumb in a corner. Like, it's insane how good he is. And his ability with like light and shadow contrast. This dude's Caravaggio in outer space. It's bananas how good he is. I can't get over it. Every time I look through these books, they make me feel bad about themselves. Okay. Come on. But look at that skull. Come on. This book is falling apart. This is two pieces because the binding broke. It's from a book called The Book of Virgil Finlay by Jerry DeLery, who made a bunch of books, made like two or three books about him because he was a huge fan. You can find them on eBay. They're not cheap. They're like 50 bucks because they're kind of falling apart, but man, they're worth it. And since they're black and white, they're printed on like kind of heavy duty paper that's not going to fall apart for the most part. He's a total genius. But again, sci-fi art is great. You should look up sci-fi art because Heavy Metal Magazine, oof, there's some, the covers of Heavy Metal Magazine and the art on the inside, but the covers are some of the best sci-fi illustration you're ever going to see. If you want to see well-made illustration that's like visually stunning and exciting, look at Heavy Metal Magazine. Without sci-fi art, you don't even get to see what you saw in like Heavy Metal album covers. Because the stuff from like sci-fi magazines and horror magazines in the 30s and 40s and 50s, that style of illustration, like that's Iron Maiden's Eddie. You know what I mean? It's that kind of fantasy-based artwork that gives us cool heavy metal album art, some new wave art, like, you know, spheres and like 80s kind of sophisticated art. Skateboard graphics, obviously. And now, to be honest, you see a lot of sci-fi style art making its way into what's considered cool young painting now. What kind of is hip now in young artists and people are kind of getting big as young painters is borderline sci-fi art. It's definitely more illustrative than it was like 5 years ago when it was just geometric abstraction. Now it's like spheres and airbrush and it all looks like a illustration annual from the mid 80s. It's like airbrush is everywhere now. And that, you know, the people doing that kind of painting are definitely looking at this kind of stuff. Because it's visually so stunning that you can make this kind of art from it easily. Like that kind of influence is making its way into fine art now. And it started in sci-fi magazines and works its way into music and then works its way into skateboarding and then now works its way into fine art. So this graphic is obviously legendary. Am I still a massive fan of Jim Phillips? Yeah, he made my favorite skate graphic ever. It's not this one, but one of my favorite skate graphic we'll get to eventually, made by him. He's still great. Maybe he's still one of the greatest. Mount Rushmore. Did he steal this from Virgil Finlay? 100%. So nobody's perfect. Everyone's complex. But he made it so I knew to look this guy up. And because of that, I have a much higher standard of what should qualify as black and white art. And how good it can look. You can't cop out and be like, oh, you can't make it dynamic because it's just black and white. Wrong. You can make it insanely dynamic if you're willing to sit there, take the time, and make it as good as it actually can be. Because that's what this guy did. He made art in black and white as good as it could be. And he ruled. So that is why this is one of my favorite stickers. Hope you guys are safe again. Stay home, man. Stay home. Don't listen to the news. Listen to the doctors. And thank you to the nurses and the people that work at supermarkets and delivery people and truck drivers and everybody, man. Reorganize your stickers. Look up Virgil Finlay on eBay. Wipe the box down with alcohol if you order it. Wipe the book down. Wash your hands, homie. We're going to get through this. Thank you for watching.